for Palm Sunday. Our Mass will be beginning outside with the blessing of the palms. So you're welcome to head out there in a couple of minutes in time to begin. If you want to wait in here, you're also welcome to do that. If you'd like your palms blessed, either ask someone to take a palm out there to get blessed and bring it in for you if you're staying in here. But otherwise, if you can head outside and make sure you grab a palm for the blessing of the palms. I think we've still got a few minutes, so we'll just give a bit more time for people to come. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Dear brothers and sisters, since the beginning of Lent until now, we have prepared our hearts by penance and charitable works. Together we gather together to herald with the whole church the beginning of the celebration of our Lord's Paschal mystery, that is to say, of his passion and resurrection. For it was to accomplish this mystery that he entered his own city of Jerusalem. Therefore, with all faith and devotion, let us commemorate the Lord's entry into the city for our salvation, following in his footsteps, so that being made by his grace partakers of the cross, we may have a share also in his resurrection and in his life. We now have the blessing of palms, so if you hold them up, let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, sanctify these branches with your blessing, that we who follow Christ the King in exaltation may reach the eternal Jerusalem through him who lives and reigns for ever and ever. Now come round and sprinkle the holy water. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. When they drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethphage and Bethany, at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord has need of it, and will send it back here immediately.' And they went away and found a colt tied at the door out in the open street, and they untied it. And those who stood there said to them, 'What are you doing, untying the colt?' And they told him what Jesus had said, and they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their garments on it, and he sat upon it. And many spread their garments on the road, and others spread leafy branches which they had cut from the fields. And those who went before and those who followed cried out, 'Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the kingdom of our father David that is coming. Hosanna in the highest.'" The Gospel of the Lord. Dear brothers and sisters, like the crowds who acclaimed Jesus in Jerusalem, let us go forth in peace. We now follow the procession into the church. Wait for the music to start. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Saviour to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God for ever and ever. Please be seated as we listen to the Word of God.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has given me a disciple's tongue, so that I may know how to reply to the wearied. He provides me with speech. Each morning he wakes me to hear, to listen like a disciple. The Lord has opened my ear. For my part, I made no resistance, neither did I turn away. I offered my back to those who struck me, my cheeks to those who tore at my hair and my beard. I did not cover my face against insult and spittle. The Lord comes to my help so that I am untouched by the insults. So too I set my face like flint. I know I shall not be shamed. The word of the Lord. My God, why have you abandoned me? All who see me deride me. They curl their lips, they toss their heads. He trusted in the Lord. Let him save him. Let him release him if this is his friend. My God, why have you abandoned me? Many dogs have surrounded me. A band of the wicked beset me. They tear holes in my hands and my feet. I can count every one of my bones. My God. They divide my clothing among them. They cast lots for my robe. O Lord, do not leave me alone. My strength, make haste to help me. My God. I will tell of your name to my brethren, and praise you where they are assembled. You who fear the Lord, give him praise. All sons of Jacob, give him glory. Revere him, Israel's son. My God, why have you abandoned?
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. His state was divine, yet Jesus Christ did not cling to his equality with God, but emptied himself to assume the condition of a slave, and became as men are, and being as all men are, he was humbler yet, even in accepting death on the cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all other names, so that all beings in the heavens, on earth, and in the underworld should bend knee at the name of Jesus, and that every tongue should acclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. Please stand for the gospel acclamation. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory. Christ, become obedient for us to death, dying on the cross. Therefore, God raised him on high and gave him a name above all others. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ, King of endless glory.
We now have the Passion narrative. And if you could, we have the text of the Passion narrative up on the screen. Please join in for the parts that are the crowd, marked C. And it is a long passion narrative, so if you'd like to sit down at some point, or sit down for it, feel free. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
It was 2 days before the Passover and the Feast of the Unleavened Bread, and the chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by some trick and have him put to death, for they said, Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper. He was at dinner when a woman came in with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment, pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the ointment on his head. Some who were there said to one another indignantly, and they were angry with her. But Jesus said,
leave her alone. Why are you upsetting her? What she has done for me is one of the good works. You have the poor with you always, and you can be kind to them whenever you wish, but you will not always have me. She has done what is in her power to do. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. I tell you solemnly, wherever throughout all the world the good news is proclaimed, what she has done will be told also in remembrance of her.
Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, approached the chief priests with an offer to hand Jesus over to them. They were delighted to hear it and promised to give him money, and he looked for a way of betraying him when the opportunity should occur. On the first day of the unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb was sacrificed, his disciples said to him, so he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
go into the city, and you will meet a man carrying a pitcher of water. Follow him and say to the owner of the house which he enters, the master says, where is my dining room in which I can eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large upper room furnished with couches, all prepared. Make the preparations for us there.
The disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them, and prepared the Passover. When evening came, he arrived with the 12, and while they were at the table eating, Jesus said,
I tell you solemnly, one of you is about to betray me, one of you eating with me.
They were distressed and asked him, one after another, he said to them,
it is one of the 12, one who is dipping into the same dish with me. Yes, the Son of Man is going to his fate, as the scriptures say he will. But alas for that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Better for that man if he had never been born.
And as they were eating, he took some bread. And when he had said the blessing, he broke it and gave it to them, saying,
take it, this is my body.
Then he took a cup, and when he had returned thanks, he gave it to them, and all drank from it. And he said to them,
this is my blood, the blood of the covenant, which is to be poured out for many. I tell you solemnly, I shall not drink any more wine until the day I drink the new wine in the kingdom of God.
After psalms had been sung, they left for the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
you will all lose faith, for the scripture says, I shall strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. However, after my resurrection, I shall go before you to Galilee.
Peter said,
even if all lose faith, I will not.
And Jesus said to him,
I tell you solemnly this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will have disowned me 3 times.
But he repeated still more earnestly,
if I have to die with you, I will never disown you.
And they all said the same. They came to a small estate called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples,
stay here while I pray.
Then he took Peter and James and John with him, and a sudden fear came over him, and great distress. And he said to them,
my soul is sorrowful to the point of death. Wait here and keep awake.
And going on a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, this hour may pass him by. He said,
Abba, Father, Everything is possible for you. Take this cup away from me, but let it be as you, not I, would have it.
He came back and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
Simon, are you asleep? Had you not the strength to keep awake 1 hour? You should be awake and praying not to be put to the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak.
Again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more he came back and found them sleeping. Their eyes were so heavy, and they could find no answer for him. He came back a third time and said to them,
You can sleep on now and take your rest. It is all over. The hour has come. Now the Son of Man is to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us go. My betrayer is close at hand already.
Even while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, came up with a number of men armed with swords and clubs, sent by the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. Now the traitor had arranged a signal with them. He had said,
The one I kiss, he is the man. Take him in charge and see he is well granted when you lead him away.
So when the traitor came, he went straight up to Jesus and said,
Rabbi,
and kissed him. The others seized him and took him in charge. Then one of the bystanders drew his sword and struck one of the high priest's servants and cut off his ear. Then Jesus spoke,
Am I a brigand that you had to set out to capture me with swords and clubs? I was among you teaching in the temple day after day, and you never laid hands on me. But this is to fulfill the scriptures.
And they all deserted him and ran away. A young man who followed him had nothing on but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the cloth in their hands and ran away naked. They led Jesus off to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders of the scribes assembled there. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the high priest's palace, and was sitting with the attendants, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus on which they might pass the death sentence, but they could not find any. Several indeed brought false evidence against him, but their evidence was conflicting. Some stood up and submitted this false evidence against him. But even on this point, the evidence was conflicting. The high priest then stood up before the whole assembly and put this question to Jesus.
Have you no answer to that? What is this evidence these men are bringing against you?
But he was silent and made no answer at all. The high priest put a second question to him.
Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?
Jesus said,
I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming with the clouds of heaven.
The high priest tore his robes and said,
What need of witness have we now? You heard the blasphemy. What is your finding?
And they all gave their verdict. He deserved to die. Some of them started spitting at him and blindfolding him, began hitting him with their fists and shouting. And the attendants rained blows on him. While Peter was down below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's servant girls came up. She saw Peter warming himself there, stared at him and said,
You too were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth.
But he denied it, saying,
I do not know, I do not understand what you are talking about.
And he went out into the forecourt. The servant girl saw him and again started telling the bystanders.
This fellow is one of them.
But again he denied it. A little later, the bystanders themselves said to Peter, But he started calling down curses on himself and swearing,
I do not know the man you speak of.
At that moment, the cock crew for the second time. And Peter recalled how Jesus had said to him, Before the cock crows twice, you will have disowned me 3 times. And he burst into tears. First thing in the morning, the chief priests, together with the elders and scribes, the whole Sanhedrin, had their plan ready. They had Jesus bound and took him away and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He answered,
"It is you who say it."
And the chief priests brought many accusations against him. Pilate questioned him again,
"Have you no reply at all? See how many accusations they are bringing against you."
But to Pilate's amazement, Jesus made no further reply. At festival time, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone they asked for. Now, a man called Barabbas was then in prison with the rioters who had committed murder during the uprising. When the crowd went up and began to ask Pilate the customary favour, Pilate answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realised it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed Jesus over. The chief priests, however, had incited the crowd to demand that he should release Barabbas for them instead. Then Pilate spoke again,
"But in that case, what am I to do with the man you call King of Jews?"
They shouted back,
"Crucify him."
Pilate asked them,
"Why? What harm has he done?"
But they shouted all the louder,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, anxious to placate the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and having ordered Jesus to be scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away to the inner part of the palace, that is the praetorium, and called the whole cohort together. They dressed him up in purple, twisted some thorns into a crown, and put it on him. And they began saluting,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
They struck his head with a reed and spat on him, and then went down on their knees to do him homage. And when they had finished making fun of him, they took off the purple and dressed him in his own clothes. They led him out to crucify him. They enlisted a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, father of Alexander and Rufus, who was coming in from the country, to carry his cross. They brought Jesus to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. They offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he refused it. Then they crucified him and shared out his clothing, casting lots to decide what each should get. It was the third hour when they crucified him. The inscription giving the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And they crucified two robbers with him, one on his right and one on his left. The passers-by jeered at him. They shook their heads and said, The chief priests and the scribes mocked him among themselves in the same way. They said, Even those who were crucified with him taunted him. When the sixth hour came, there was a darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice,
"Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,"
which means, my God, why have you deserted me?" When some of those who stood by this heard, they said, Someone ran and soaked a sponge in vinegar, putting it on a reed, gave it to him, saying,
"Wait and see if Elijah will come to take him down."
But Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the veil of the temple was torn in two, from top to bottom. The centurion who was standing in front of him had seen how he had died, And he said,
"In truth, this man was the Son of God."
There were some women watching from a distance. Among them were Mary of Magdala, Mary who was the mother of James the younger, and Joset, and Salome. They used to follow him and look after him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women who had come up to Jerusalem with him. It was now evening, and since it was preparation day, that is the vigil of the Sabbath, there came Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council who himself lived in the hope of seeing the kingdom of God. And he boldly went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate, astonished that he should have died so soon, summoned the centurion and inquired if he was already dead. Having been assured of this by the centurion, he granted the corpse to Joseph, who brought a shroud, took Jesus down from the cross, wrapped him in the shroud, and laid him in the tomb, which had been hewn out of rock. He then rolled a stone against the entrance to the tomb. Mary of Magdala and Mary, the mother of Joseph, were watching and took note of where he was laid.
Please be seated. And so this day, Passion Sunday or Palm Sunday, we set the scene for entering into the whole of Holy Week. We've just read through all the events which we celebrate leading up to the rising of Christ on Easter Sunday. And we have contrasted, put together the entrance, the triumphant entrance into Jerusalem and the mocking and humiliation and suffering of Christ on the cross. And those are put before us as a contrast to sort of show how quickly the people turned against him. But also for us, from our perspective, we see a similarity, because on the cross is Christ's triumph. On the cross, we see the victory over sin and suffering and death. Christ's love proved stronger. And so we see on the cross his victory, a crushing victory over the worst the world could offer. And so as we enter into this Holy Week, let us carry with us the image of the cross, both the recollection of the suffering that Jesus endured out of love for us. Let us keep that particularly in our mind, in every aspect of the week ahead, when we really focus on who we are as Christians. People are marked by the cross, people in whom we see our identity in the cross. Every little suffering and inconvenience or challenge or task, see it as something that we have the invitation to unite with the love of Christ on the cross. And as we do so with confidence in the power of Christ, that this love of Christ, which has conquered sin and death, is available to us to enter into our hearts and give an energy and life to those acts of love that we wouldn't be able to do ourselves. Let us, while recognizing his love and suffering for us, also recognize his triumph and his victory and the hope that this gives us, that we can love with a purity that we couldn't hope for otherwise. So let us pray that Christ's passion and victory may be in our hearts and minds and guiding our lives as we reflect on and participate in the mysteries throughout this Holy Week.
Let us profess our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Our King has entered his city. Our palms and cries of homage fade away as the words of the Gospel tell the story of his suffering and death. Let us bring our prayers to the Father through the Son he gave up for us with love beyond our comprehension.
For the church, that in a world torn by conflict and strife, it may be a sign of unity and an instrument of peace. Lord, hear us. For political and civil leaders, that they may strive to create a society in which people can enjoy freedom, security, and peace. Lord, hear us. For those who suffer, that the example of Jesus may help them to bear their sufferings with patience and fortitude. Lord, hear us. For a spirit of penance, reflection, and gratitude during these chosen days. Lord, hear us. For the gentle repose of the faithful departed, especially Roma Ryan, Ross Fitzpatrick, and those whose anniversaries occur around this time, Arthur Murphy, Darcy Dempsey, Judith Pollock, Catherine Pora, Lorna Riley, Sean Cartledge, Janita Adlam, Maureen Rhoda, Patricia Angelini, Joan Wright, that the Lord may welcome them into his kingdom as he welcomed the repentant thief. Lord, hear us. Our parish prayer. God our Father, bless our parish so that we may love you more. Encircle our families with your loving care. Help parents to be a good example to their children and our youth to grow in strength as good Christians. To the sick grant health, to the aged bring serenity, and to those in sorrow joy. May we grow stronger in faith, and may our love for one another become deeper in our daily living. Amen.
Lord and Father, with serene courage, your Son went forth to die for us. Grant us a share in his strength as we bring these prayers before you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Will you give me your life forever? Will you carry my cross every day? Will you walk in the light of my presence? Will you follow the truth of my ways? Will you love me as I have loved you? Will you live with me the darkness as I die? For the moon and the stars will be gone like the night, and the sun will be shining on you. Like the purest of gold in the furnace, is your love strong enough to endure? Does your faith carry on through the shadows? Does it shine in the night for the world? Will you love me as I as I die? For the moon and the stars will be gone like the night, and the sun will
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that, though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice, made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners, and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice, for on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. And giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Liborius and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope and Shane our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours for ever and ever. Amen. At the Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Of life and power, my
Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please take note of all the Mass times in the bulletin and ceremonies for Holy Week, including opportunities for the Sacrament of Confession. Also in the bulletin is information about Divine Mercy Sunday devotions. That's the Sunday after Easter. And if you're interested in taking part in that, one part of the devotions is a Divine Mercy Novena, which begins on Good Friday. So if you'd like more information about that, there's some Divine Mercy materials at the back of the church. But there's also a website in the bulletin where you can find out more as well. This Tuesday, it's quite a big event at the cathedral with the Chrism Mass, and it's particularly invited that people come from many different parishes to unite in celebrating this Mass, as it's also a celebration of the 150th anniversary of the diocese. The Lord be with you. Bow down for the blessing. Look, we pray, O Lord, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ did not hesitate to be delivered into the hands of the wicked and submit to the agony of the cross, who lives and reigns for ever and ever.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Amen.